Welcome to this Friday forum. We are such a small group that we're probably going to try to not use any of the microphones here, so I encourage those that are in the back to just come forward and feel more integrated, especially since this will have a decent part of conversation built into this talk. It'd be nice if you were close. We have our guest today, Dr. Stephen Miles. He is the Provost and Vice President of Academic Affairs at New College of Florida in Sarasota, Florida. He's also the Director of New Music, New College, which is a concert series that focuses on new and experimental music by performers from all over the country and world that come to Sarasota on a series about five to six concerts a year. And this experience, that tradition started actually in 1998 with a concert of John Cage's songbooks, a very large work for a large number of performers that work within a space and that each person has a number of different tasks to do. And this was done while I was a student at New College. And this was not only the introduction to New Music, New College in a particular way of trying to put on these larger works involving contemporary avant-garde music, but also my introduction to John Cage and the power that the experience of performing and putting these pieces together can create for artistic endeavors and for combining various forms of musical expression in a single space, and also putting it into an unusual space. In this case, it was into an art gallery, but it wasn't just in a stationary space. It was positioned all over the various rooms and different galleries within that space. So the performers are free to move around, but so are the audience members are free to move around, but so are the performers. The performers were also had different stations that they moved to, and there was a sense of freedom and liberation for a performer as well as an audience members, in the sense that it's a dynamic experience that would be completely dependent on where you were situated at any one time. And this had a great influence on me. I since then became quite passionate about these topics myself, and now lead my own ensemble here called MEME, which I see at least a few members of in this room, the Mississippi Experimental Music Ensemble, where we actually do similar things like this ourselves. So without further ado, I'm very, very happy to introduce my former professor and provost of New College of Florida, Stephen Miles.
Thank you. It's really great to be back in Jackson. I've been to Jackson four or five times. I won't go into all the reasons why, but I do have friends here, Lynn Rayleigh and Rachel, and at least one other graduate in town, so there have been reasons. It's been great. That concert that Jason mentioned in 1998 was intended to be a one-off. There was an exhibition of sculptures by Joseph Beuys going on at the museum, and so we were asked to come in, and the word was around that I'd perform John Cage, and Cage and Beuys had some connections, so they asked if I would do this. And we really just thought this was going to be, we'd do the concert, how nice, and that was it. But it got this enormous response. And I think a lot of it had to do with things such as Jason was talking about, that it was the music, which, it was John Cage, and in Sarasota, even in 1998, so it's John Cage, this does send, little ripples of fear to the audience. So there were people who came thinking, I like Steve, but I think I'm going to hate this, that kind of thing. But it was spectacularly successful. And part of it had to do with what Jason referred to, the fact that we were not performing the Cage songbooks on stage like this for an audience that's seated as you are, where you're, like Jonathan there, you look very confined, Jonathan, because you have, you have a little desk in front of you and so forth. You're not going anywhere. Or if you were to go somewhere, it would be really noticeable. Right. So people feel trapped in this kind of setting. Whereas what Jason was describing was where the audience, the performers were mobile, and the audience had lots of choices. So we that was not only was not only a positive experience in performing the cage, but one of the things we learned from that, that may probably will come in to this talk a little bit, is that every musical work has both a compositional structure, an aesthetic structure, but it also has an implicit reception structure, okay? Meaning that there's some music that's absolutely perfect for a concert hall, because you know, the point is you have to be still and listen and track what's going on and you know, use your memory and be undistracted, and the focus is on what's being done by the performers. And so it's having highly determinate music, having a highly determinate performance space is totally consonant and makes sense. But John Cage's music is in many ways indeterminate. Okay, so there are aspects of it that are either chance-based or are going to be different in every performance. And if you put that kind of music in a highly determinate reception space, there's a dissonance, and people think they don't like the music, but it may not be the music they don't like. It's somehow the disjunction between the way it's being presented and what's and the nature of the music itself. So one of the things that we try to do with New Music New College is to always think about, you know, whatever it is that we're going to perform, whether it's an original work or a work, you know, a pre-existing work, we never start with where it's going to be performed. We always think, well, what would be the most appropriate place in which to perform it? So sometimes that might be outside, sometimes that might be in an art gallery, sometimes that would be in a club, like a art jazz club or something. So we use space in that way. That's a little bit of that's a digression before I've even gotten started. But that performance in 1988 really was a life-changing experience for me, and I think for many of the people who were involved. Jason was being a little bit modest at the beginning. He was talking about New Music New College, and we had these guest artists who come in. Last January, we had a chamber orchestra from New York, Ensemble Misson, that performed the piano concerto of Georg Ligeti. And they also performed one of Jason's works for a chamber orchestra, and it was totally successful. So he was on the stage holding his own, mano a mano, with Gary Ligeti. It was really impressive. It's really impressive. So anyway, it's really great to be back here. Another thing, I've been interested in Millsaps because New College and Millsaps were sort of. We rub up against each other in national rankings and guidebooks.
That's right.
We do. It's like, you don't know New College, but why are they always, you know, ranked with us? And we are both in the book by Lauren Pope, Colleges That Change Lives. I think that in terms of what I'm going to talk about today, where again the title of this talk is The X Factor is What Every Educator Can Learn from John Cage. I'm really speaking about the implications of John Cage's work, not just for music. That just happens to be my own area. But it could be in any field whatsoever, because it really gets into questions about learning. I trust that there are some non-musicians here. Oh, great. Excellent. Are you faculty or staff here?
Philosophy.
Oh, great, philosophy. Excellent. Okay, and what about you?
Art history faculty.
This is terrific. I've worked in the
English department.
English?
English, and I'm the Associate Dean of Arts and Humanities.
Great, okay. So, and the rest of you. The others are music in some way, right? Okay, I want to ask a question before we get started. If the name John Cage comes up, and you can just offer a one-word response in terms of your association. Think of this as like psychotherapy or something. So I say John Cage, and you say?
Experimental.
Okay. Boy, you read up. I can tell this. Somebody else. Right, okay. John Cage.
Silence.
Okay. Experimental. Silence. John Cage. Random, okay, oh, this is so great. This is so great, randomness. Okay, any other associations? Yes,
right. Anti-establishment.
Anti-establishment. Oh, but yeah, that's so incredibly ironic. That is just so ironic. Um, Well, it is ironic. Oh, it did go to sleep. No, there it is. Okay. Lynn and I went to the same conservatory, and in Cincinnati. You always have to take a deep breath before I say the name of this place because it has so many names. It's the University of Cincinnati College Conservatory of Music. Yeah, it's really long. CCM, yes, for those in the know. And so I studied composition there, and my impressions of John Cage, and this is 1972, but my just based on the attitudes of my composition professors, John Cage was pretty much a fraud, a charlatan, and kind of a joke, you know. And if not, maybe not a joke, but kind of gave new music a bad name. This is 1972. 1964, Leonard Bernstein conducted the New York. There was a festival, I think, of new music. And he conducted a performance of Cage's work, Atlas Ecliptikalis. And the musicians sabotaged the performance. It's a piece where all of them function as soloists and they have to play for certain periods of time and they're asked to do various things with their instruments. And the musicians in rehearsal and then later in performance basically treated it like it was a joke. They would play whatever they wanted to play, or they'd make funny sounds, or they'd hit the music stands, or whatever. It was a complete scandal. So when Rachel says anti-establishment, certainly for much of John Cage's career, that is how he was perceived. Now the fact is, you don't have to be in music to know that John Cage is arguably one of the, say, five most influential artists and thinkers of the 20th century. And his influence is stronger now, in one sense, than it even was in his lifetime. Okay? It's hard to think of composers and artists and dancers, writers who have not in some way, everybody's like, should know something about John Cage, or they've been influenced by him in some way. He has certainly influenced my thinking about music and my thinking about teaching. And so in order to talk, I'm going to talk about Cage, but I think in order to understand how he had an impact on me as a teacher, I need to tell you a little bit about my story. So I teach at New College, but I came from the University of Illinois, did my graduate work there. University of Illinois, it's, you know, a research one kind of place, and musicians live in their own enclave and mostly create for each other, just like the folks in computer science are mostly creating for each other, or the people in biology are doing their work for each other. It's very much the culture of experts, where experts are speaking to other experts, and that's the whole function of an R1. More knowledge, more research. Then I came to New College in 1988, and New College is very, very different from the University of Illinois, and very different from the Cincinnati Conservatory. New College is, in some respects, a hybrid. I mean, it actually has a lot in common with Millsaps from the standpoint of liberal arts as a foundation, high academic standards, etc. But it also, so it's very much part of the liberal arts, honors liberal arts tradition in American higher ed. But we also partake of the, what could be called the experimental strain in American higher ed. These would be schools like Hampshire, Evergreen State, Bennington in the old days. We don't use grades. We use narrative evaluations for every class. Every student receives a narrative evaluation. Students have enormous agency in designing their academic path. Many of them don't wear shoes. If you lived in Florida, you might not be wearing shoes either. But no, so it's this interesting hybrid of being a very, very brainy place. Like New College, this is, as I'm provost, I've had to memorize 1,000 statistics about New College. But one of them is that according to the National Science Foundation, looking at colleges and universities throughout the United States and ranking them on the basis of the percentage of graduates who go on to get the PhD in the sciences, Caltech is first, Harvey Mudd is second, New College is third, and MIT is fourth. So that kind of says something, at least there.
Why are you ranked with us?
What's that? But there are, believe me, New College is, it attracts very brainy students and also very creative students. And when I came to New College, one of the things that I found, I loved the place. I mean, I fell in love with it when I came down for my interview and loved being there. I've been there since 1988, so that must tell you something. But I did find that I faced a challenge in that coming from a place like the University of Illinois, teaching only music majors, teaching students, all of whom were headed into music, either music education or music performance, the expectation of what they knew technically about music was much higher. So, and also the music that I wrote when I came to New College was music that really my students were not prepared to play. I was being played by music by people elsewhere, but there was this disjunction that opened up. I loved my students, we had a great time, but I always felt like there was something, some part of their enormous intelligence and creativity that I wasn't tapping into quite. Now, when Jason mentioned, like the John Cage performance, when I turned to Cage, it really changed everything for me. I was fortunate enough while I was at the University of Illinois to work with a man named William Brooks, who's a big Cage scholar and a composer and a choral conductor, and I was able to perform Cage with Bill Brooks. That told me, I really learned how much discipline there was involved with this work. So it's in this setting of, here I am, this trained expert, working with students who are incredibly smart, but they may not have the technical background, okay? I turned to Cage because Cage engaged their experience, okay? And the first of the lessons, if you will, from Cage is really the primacy of experience. So what I'm gonna do now is I'd like for us to participate in a performance of his most famous work, 4 minutes and 33 seconds. Everybody knows what this, at this point it's almost like, most everyone knows 4 minutes and 30 seconds, the silent piece, etc. And it's supposed to be 4 minutes and 33 seconds long, right? The piece has gotten much longer over the years. It was created in 1948, 46, 48, in that area. 4 minutes and 33 seconds of silence is harder for us today, feels longer than it does for us today than it did, 60 some odd years ago, whatever. Because we're thinking, where's my phone? I have 30 seconds. Oh, right, I could take care of two emails in 30 seconds, or what's up next on my chat, on my text, We're hyper-stimulated, and this is a piece that is about being still, being quiet, and being attentive. So it's actually in three parts, and the piece is scored. Originally, it was scored for piano, in which the pianist sits at the keyboard, and then after 33 seconds, rises and raises the lid. And then sits down, then at 1 minute, after two minutes and 40 seconds, closes the lid, sits down, and then the piece is over when 4 minutes and 33 seconds has passed. So I will use the chairs to mark these transitions. So, is everyone ready? That's your last chance, okay. It begins. What did you experience in those 4 minutes and 32 seconds? Do you have, would you like to speak?
Very long.
It's very long.
Very long.
Yeah, I know. It's really long. Say that again. What the, yeah.
All kinds of sounds, and I think that the capturing of the earth sounds, found sounds, like found objects.
Yes.
Right. So that you realize that there is no such thing as silence or calmness around music of a sort.
Yeah, Cage, as an experiment, he entered, I guess it was at Harvard over here, but they had this as an anechoic chamber, is that what it's called? But basically, it's like no sounds whatsoever. And he said he could still hear two sounds. He could hear the sound of his heart beating, and he could also hear a little high-pitched sound. It was his nervous system in operation. So that was one really important for him to say, there is no such thing as silence. Other things, yeah, Lynn?
I think maybe what Elise is saying is a lot of what we all say in our music reports, that was sort of Cage's point. It struck me for the first time thinking about listening to this piece, that this was like one of those moments of silence in memory of this Cage, John Cage. But I wonder, it seems to me that he's trying, I don't know what he's trying to do exactly. This is outer directed, it's what Lisa's talking about. Mm-hmm. How does this now become a piece suddenly that has to do with mindfulness and meditation? So it's also Cage with Buddhists. Mm-hmm. Is that any component of it that you can?
I'm looking around like there's somebody else already. I think that
it becomes you then.
I think that mindfulness in one sense, and he practiced in Buddhism. And part of it is a state of attention and of welcoming, or at least attending to experience without judgment. That's really sort of the core of the intersection of Cage's music and his Zen Buddhism, right? So that for 4 minutes and 33 seconds, there are sounds. As he would say, there is more than enough for us to listen to. And I was struck here by sounds that, because it sounds like there's nothing going on, and we could hear occasionally someone would shift in the seat, or we could hear some people walking outside, right? But the sound of the AC or the heating unit, whatever, was interesting for me to hear how that's actually several different sounds, because mostly I was hearing the sound, I would say it's the sound of the fan. But then you listen, and there's also a deeper sound. So it's like several different sounds. And from Cage's standpoint, I mean, it's there is so much for us to experience that we usually don't. And actually, this gets into a really important point. And the reason I did this under the primacy of experience is that from the standpoint of my teaching, I really believe that unless students are engaged experientially, they are learning about, they are not invested in learning with, learning from. This piece is not a concept. It's a frame for experience. When you hear about the piece, it's a concept. You know, it's a silent piece. That's a concept. But experiencing 4 minutes and 33 seconds is attending to whatever it may be. It could also be anxiety. It could be, you know, any number of things that surface, just like in meditation. It's not that you quit thinking, it's that you quit trying not to do it. It's like it comes and you dismiss it, or it comes and you let it go, it comes and let it go. It's about attention. And the thing about this piece is, and with much of Cage's work, is that students, it doesn't require necessarily traditional musical skills. It does require discipline. Cage's reputation is that of being all about freedom, all about anarchy and all that. And actually for Cage, it's equally balanced throughout his entire career between freedom and law. It's always about the two in equal measure. It's just the form that the disciplines take is different depending upon the stage. So with this piece, I found it, you know, with cages, I'm trying to think of where I was, my thought, I kind of go off on that. Oh, yes, right. This is about attending to sounds and hearing them for what they are. Cage's least favorite composer was Beethoven. And it's kind of shocking when you're a music student and you read what it says about Beethoven. But Beethoven, from his position, Beethoven is a composer where you don't listen to the sounds, you're listening to the relationship of the sounds. That listening to a Beethoven symphony is, in a sense, not simply to, it's not hearing moment by moment, or at least implicitly by the formal implications. It's not, it's about memory, it's about tracking a relationship. Music that's in one key to music that's in another key, the change in the structure of a melody. And again, there's not that there's anything wrong with that, okay? But from Cage's standpoint, that aspect of our tradition has both strongly identified what music is about, which is about the creation, your creation of relationships, and about limiting the sounds that are musical to a very small group of sounds, okay, that are suitable for a Beethoven symphony. Cage was one of his, before he became John Cage, who everybody knows about, he created percussion music. And these are still wonderful works. Most of them are fully notated. But the point was, at that point, what percussion was about was expanding the range of what could constitute a musical sound. For him, it was a very natural progression to go further into all sounds. In the interest of time, the main thing here, in terms of this first notion, when I say the primacy of experience, Cage focuses on experience. And the irony is that from the standpoint of audiences, once they get that he's actually not about you, it's not about grasping some arcane concept. It's not about needing an education. It's not about some kind of elite understanding. It's about your experience. And once people understand that, and they become attentive to their experience, they really start to learn. My sense in my teaching is that it's only when students are grounded in their experience that they really do start to learn. So I think this transcends music education. This is in everything. How can we engage students at the level of experience in whatever it is that we're teaching? Now the second X factor, if you will, is exploration. Now you can think that exploration, yeah, sure, contemporary composers are always exploring, artists are always exploring, philosophers are always exploring. I'm going to talk here about the imperative exploration. I think that Cage's work takes the implications of modernity and simply takes them, maybe interprets them in the most radical way. Now, and so when I'm referring to modernity, I'm referring to, you know, the cultural development in which tradition and traditional knowledge and traditional understanding was subjected to scientific critique. That is the moment in which we began to, this is going back to Galileo and, you know, early science, but looking at the natural world and saying, we don't rely on myth, we don't rely on tradition to understand, that we rely on empirical science, we rely on empirical experimentation. It starts in science, but it becomes the defining current of modernity itself, which is that tradition, it's not that tradition goes away. Traditions don't go away. Look at where we are today. I mean, you know, it's not that people quit being religious. It's none of that. But it's more that the context in which they're religious changes. My family are Baptists, and they have firm beliefs about religion and salvation, but they don't burn people who think differently. Now, they believe it passionately, they believe it is the truth, but they're ironic in the way they approach it. They know that other people don't necessarily believe that, and they shouldn't be killed for that. Now, I'm saying that there's a certain pluralism and irony that we take for granted that's modern. And what really is frightening about so much of what we see, say with ISIS and all this, is that, no, you can't be killed because you don't believe something. That's fun. I mean, so the modern spirit is to recognize that the things that we hold to be true are often the creation, or they correspond to conventions, they correspond to traditions and things that have happened over time, that they are subject to critique. Now in music, we start to see this in particular, like say in the 18th century, even with late Mozart. You can look at late, there's a wonderful essay by Rose Rosenberg Sabotnick called Evidence of a Critical Worldview in the Late Symphonies of Mozart. And what she shows is how Mozart, on the one hand, he's still using the conventions of symphonic form, but he is increasingly showing how arbitrary some of those formal procedures are. The harmonic schemes in the development sections of some of the symphonies, he modulates to some completely remote area, and then seemingly, in just response to the convention, goes back to what he's required to do. As opposed to constructing a justification for it, he sort of lets us see that, you know, I really don't have to go back. I'm just going back because that's what I'm supposed to do here. Late Beethoven's trick with it, like something like the Opus 130 B flat quartet. First movement is very, very modern in the sense that it's in sonata, it follows sonata principles, but it sort of explodes it. It's like taking it all over the place. But the next movement is a slavishly conventional movement. And he juxtaposes those as if to say, you know, sometimes we're really conventional, but we don't really, that's not because we have to be, all right? So the modern, when I think of modernity, is something in music. I mean, Schoenberg, for example, didn't just up and become right atonal music. I mean, that started from a gradual loosening of some of the of principles that would seem to be almost God-given. But this, when you think about our society, we live by following something like Jürgen Habermas. We live in a post-traditional society. It's not to say there aren't traditions. There are, but they don't carry inherent authority. The authority is kind of earned, all right? That we, and that's a very different position. Now the relation for this for Cage is that Cage is exploring new definitions of music, and in a sense, because there are no conventions that you can simply fall back upon and say, well, that's what music is. If we had a conversation right now, what is music? You know, it's sound, come up with the usual kinds of things. But eventually we'd start talking about some things that actually are just historical convention. Now Cage is pushing and saying, well, if music is if we can't just have an accepted, received notion of what music is, then let's explore what else is possible. So this the imperative towards exploration is, and this is something I think that can be brought into teaching on every level, is to understand what it's like to learn under conditions of modernity, which is to understand that modernity is not something, I mean, like, again, my parents would not think of themselves as, well, we're proponents of modernity. But their very irony, the irony that they take, the ironic position they take towards what they believe to be absolute truth, that they can still be ironic enough about that to allow for pluralism, shows how deeply modern they are. Okay? So Cage is just a more radical version of that, all right? But for all of us, no matter what we're teaching, no matter what we're looking at, to understand that we do it within the context of modernity is really important. The third lesson, and this kind of follows from that, is the third X factor, if you will, is the necessity of experimentation. So Cage, you might say that Cage is thinking, all right, so I'm grounded in experience, and there aren't conventions that are received and accepted. about what music is. Cage wanted to find ways out of how to get away from the confines of his own taste, his own preferences. Experimentation, using chance procedures, using the I Ching, using all these different things, all of that was an effort to hear sounds that he would not have come up with himself. It sounds a little perverse, but it follows pretty naturally. If experience, you don't want to be, you know, experience could just become your own subjective experience. He's actually pushing himself in a disciplined way to hear things, create the circumstances in which we're all going to hear things that we wouldn't have chosen. It's a very disciplined position, and I realize that. And I'm not going to talk more about that, but the fourth X factor is excellence. And I would call it sort of a redefinition or a definition of modern excellence. And it follows from all of these, which is modern excellence means, and this kind of gets back to this post-traditional position, living in modernity doesn't mean that you ignore tradition. I think it means that you are responsible for mastering that tradition, but you also then have to understand it's contingent, it's historically formed, and Cage inspires us and teaches us how to, in a sense, push beyond that. One of the most fun times for me as a teacher are those moments, those particular semesters, when I'm teaching music theory 2 in the morning and teaching experimental music and theory and practice in the afternoon, and with the same students. So in one class, I'm really making them stickler for four-part writing, you know? Not because God wanted it, but, you know, because it's how you learn voice leading and all that. And in the afternoon, we're working with chance procedures. And it reminds me of, in the Odyssey, Penelope has to fend off the suitors while Odysseus is gone. You know, how she does this is she says that she's weaving a burial shroud for her father, who's very old and is going to die soon. And she says, well, when I'm finished with the shroud, I'll marry one of the suitors. Well, her trick is that she weaves it during the day and unweaves it at night. So it's never finished. And I feel like the definition of modern excellence is that we have to be equally devoted to weaving and unweaving, okay? It's not enough to be unweaving, okay? I don't say to students, oh, you don't have to know all that history. You know, just use your ears, you know? The definition of modern excellence is that we are equally committed to the traditions that precede us and to their contingency. And if we do that, we are participating in that modern project. Okay. So I think that applies to almost anything that we're teaching. Okay, it's a relationship to the past that both acknowledges the debt, but also involves the obligation that we're not repeating that. Okay. I know that this has gone on much longer than I had expected it to, but I hope we have a few minutes at least for some conversation. Are there other questions? Yes.
I wanted to say I love that with the analogy with yeah, I think that's such a, it's going to stick with me as a really interesting notion. But I wanted to go back to the Cage piece and ask about the title of it, the time that it gives us, 1 minute and 33 seconds, which is really different from 4 minutes.
Right.
Because it's got this poetic extension to it. It seems like a very poetic title to me, but it also maybe has ramifications of like 33 RPM. And so I'm wondering what, if you know anything about his rationale for this.
I'm going to look here at Jason, because Jason might actually know. I'm pretty sure that there was some chance involved with that. But I think what's interesting about what you just said, notice how much thought you brought to it. Right? I mean, it's not just 4 minutes. All right, so there's something, what else is that? And then you're thinking about 33 RPMs. You know, in other words, you are, this is the nature of being human, right? That we take the environment and we will make sense of it. All right. I mean, there's an author, Donald Spence. He wrote a book called Historical Truth and Narrative Truth. And he said the most insidious thing about the search for meaning is that it always succeeds. Now, in the sense that, I mean, mind you, I'm not saying that what you were saying means that you're putting meaning on it, but I think that what we do and what Cage's work stimulates for us is we think about our experience and we think about the conditions that led to that experience. I think that I could imagine a really interesting essay about how the 33, why the 33 is important, and how somehow it comes into the way you experience it, right? I mean, it's really interesting. Question. Any other?
I can respond to that. Maybe it ruins the mystique that you just provided, but the reason why I spoke for 33 was because it had to do with zero Kelvin. That zero K equals something like -433 Celsius, or 433 is what, 273 seconds? Or is it -273 Celsius? So it had to do with that.
Oh, okay.
That's how it originally was formed. But then there's still this decision of how many seconds per movement, which is actually very specifically delineated. So there's still this decision-making process and still this consideration of why this length versus that length.
Anything else? Yes,
please. So, going back to the education thing. So, is it just that we're thinking about these wonderful X concepts and how they can such a way help us think about education, or is there something more in terms of, I mean, today you helped us experience this one piece, is there something more directly that we can use of Cage's? So I'm thinking at least in art history, is there some way that some Cage piece could open up students' visual perception? Is there some way that in the philosophy class, Cage can open up something that nothing else would open up?
Yeah, philosophers do love Cage. I mean, at least many, because it's so rich in implications for thinking. I was going to play, but decided not to. Some of the sonatas and interludes. Oh, actually, here's a piece that I would really recommend that you all check out. It's called Living Room Music. Actually, it'd be a really great.
Did you do it?
Okay.
In 2008.
Yeah. So this is a piece in which all the rhythms, everything is written out. The rhythms are complete, but the instruction is it should be performed on household objects or architecture, right? So, you know, this could become, you know, you play it there. We staged it at New Music New College, like in a student's dorm room. And there were four people in the dorm room to start beating on things. But, so I guess it's kind of hard for me to answer that question really well. I will say this, I've gone from, to use an analogy, I live in a community where a lot of people, there's a pattern for older people, particularly in Sarasota, that they started coming down there first to vacation, then they bought a little second apartment or something so they could stay longer, and then eventually they retired there. That's kind of like my relationship with Cage. I performed it the first time. It was kind of like a little vacation. Like, this is really, really interesting. And Beethoven seems very different now. But you know, but I'm not living here. You know, this is Cage. I'm just visiting, right? You know. Then I went through a period where it's kind of like I have an apartment and I spend more time. I'm more or less retired now than John Cage. So it's been a progression. And I'd say it's gone from seeing it as a relief or as a contrast to music as much as something that it's a profound starting point, actually, for music. So I guess I would just say we should, and this maybe is getting back to anti-establishment, or Cage has gone from being that extra kind of quirky, weird, to being foundational. That's how far Kate and we have come. So maybe we'll stop there. Thank you.